Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Good afternoon, everyone. How are you doing today?
Yeah.
Even sir, doing okay.
Nice. What about Jutivia, Danielia, and Alexi? Alexia, Kylo.
What do you mean?
I'm good, sir.
All right. So, so I'm being very disobedient tonight. Being very disobedient, and the reason I'm being very disobedient is because I don't have much time. The doctor says that I'm supposed to be resting my voice. That's why it's just not getting better. Try as I may and do all the things that I'm supposed to be doing, it's still just not breaking. So I'm going to try and not do as much talking tonight. I'm going to see how much I can preserve it. I think I did a good job today by just resting it. Hopefully by Wednesday, I should be able to go full force. I have two topics left to complete. And I'm pretty confident that I'll be able to complete those topics. But just to let you know, I won't be doing as much. I'll try not to do as much talking tonight, and see how best I can try and preserve. I have two areas to complete, and I really want to complete those areas. And then you have a major project for me. So what I'm going to do now, I'm just going to open the floor to find out if there is, if there are any questions, if you need any clarification on anything, because for sure, I would love for us to have that presentation next week. I would want to have that presentation next week, either next week, Monday or Wednesday. I will let you know by Wednesday coming, by this Wednesday, when I look back at my schedule. So we are going to be having, that presentation. So I'm going to ask that you make sure that you start your stuff. As I told you before, it is a group work. It's not supposed to be very difficult, etc. I am yet to receive from you the final division of labor. I see things in the WhatsApp group. I need to be presented with the final division of labor as to who will be doing what exactly. And until I receive that, I'll let you know when it is that we're going to be having the presentations. So I'm going to ask you just to say to me, ask me whatever questions you need to ask as it relates to the project at hand. Are there any questions? Are there any difficulties? Let me know. How are things going? Okay. Is anyone hearing me?
Yes, sir.
Oh, because I just asked a question a while ago and nobody's responding, so I was just wondering.
I think it's going well so far.
Thank you. I might just sit and wait for somebody to respond to me, or should I just log off and go and lie down and rest myself? Which is it?
Sir, I just logged down and didn't hear what you said.
That's all right, Paz. There are others who were here. I would have heard. I soon talk to you.
I responded. I didn't hear him when I responded.
I didn't hear Asia, but what was your response, Asia?
I was saying everything was good so far.
Oh, I didn't hear that. Okay, everything is good so far for you, Asia. Very nice. Dowdin, you said that you heard me, so is there a response? All right. Okay, all right. I won't. That's fine. I won't. I know I would have given you an opportunity to ask me anything. So I'm moving on. And when it is that we have the presentation, I will just mark accordingly, because I can't understand that at the university level that we are giving a lecturer coming to ask you, how are things going, so that seemingly you could get some help, should in case I have any difficulty and no response. So that's fine. It's perfectly fine. All right. What I have done
is, sir,
yes, Michael.
Sir. Yeah, I was away for a little bit. The presentation, is it for the assignment that Asia placed in the group?
Is that it, Asia? I don't know. What did Asia place in the group?
The energy.
Yes.
Well, that's not the individual work.
No, that's not the individual. That's a group piece. But within the group piece, you have individual piece. All right. So in the for the major group work that was placed in the group, I had to be very careful how I responded to you, because I didn't know who placed it in the group. But the group work, the major piece on energy, though a group work, and you'll be getting grouped marks. There are individual components to the research. So each person is going to be required to do a section by themselves. So this is where the division of labor is very critical for me to be presented with a listing of the areas to be covered by students. Now, it may mean, and I gave you the freedom in doing this, it may mean that two people may be looking at oil, or two people may be looking at fossil, or one person may be looking at fossil. I just need to know, so that when I am marking, I know if that person or persons are deviating or sticking to what it is that they are doing, and just to have an idea that the work is evenly spread, because I don't want one person to just stick a one paragraph and thinks, boy, that is it. So I'm waiting to be presented with the division of labor so I can comment on it. That's one. And two, just wanted to find out if you're having any difficulties with what is expected of you to put you on a track, because I would want the presentation to be done sometime next week. As soon as I get the division of labor, I will go through it. I will communicate to you, this is good to go. Yes, you can move on. I will be very disappointed if people start working without getting the go-ahead from me. So, which is why I'm asking for the division of labor. And I'm not asking, well, I was asking, because I'm not asking anymore, if people had any difficulty.
The division of labor is the persons who are responsible for each section that is assigned, right?
Very good.
All right, that's in the group. But the thing is this, you know, I have almost completed this. I thought it was, we had signed off on it.
No, because almost I mean, complete. No, but almost. I mean, no. Hold on. Don't get me wrong. You know, all I'm saying to you is, I don't know. I'm seeing things in the group, but no one, or no group member, or no. I have not heard from anybody. I've seen people saying, "Add me to this. This is my ID number." put somebody else to this, but I don't know if this is the final stuff. So I'm waiting to hear from the students of the class to say, sir, this is a final piece. This is a division of labor. This is what we're doing, so that I can look at it to say, this is this and this is that. So I just need to know or be presented with it to say that this is the final piece, sir. Right? Because for sure, I can't be marking something from a WhatsApp, right? So I'd expect that some responsible person would say, I don't know if it's where I'm going, to send me an email to say, sir, this is, yeah. So I wouldn't look at a WhatsApp piece of work in progress when you're trying to fine tune, you know, a piece of exercise in WhatsApp and then take it and mark it. I would expect, because all this evidence now will have to be put up so that should in case an external moderator wants to find out how it is that I assessed geology for this semester, I can say, this is what was done, and I can have it as a soft copy. I can email it to the person to say, this is this. I can't be taking something from WhatsApp to here. Also, you never did finish this so far, whatever the situation is. So I would expect, you know, somebody to say, sir, this is the final copy. It's a group presentation. So if there's a group leader, just to say, this is the final copy, sir, then I can take it to say, this is it, because there is a percentage for the Division of Labor also, right? So I'm still waiting, right? So I'm not saying what it is that you have done, Michael, can't be used. I'm just saying that I need to see this before you move into the stuff. So please let me have that soonest so that I can have a look at it. I'd really want to get the presentation out of the way. I have your other pieces ready, but I don't want an overflow to give you I'm sure by Wednesday I'll give you the other pieces. I want to give you, well, I'll tell you about that one.
Sir, we're not hearing you. Well, sir, I kicked off.
I'm still there, but we're just not hearing.
You're not hearing me at all?
You're hearing you now, sir.
You're hearing you now.
Oh, okay. No, man. All right, thanks. I'm still here. What I did tonight, because I don't know what has been happening for the last couple of classes. Even on the weekend when I was having classes, students were complaining that they weren't hearing me. I mean, outside of my very annoying voice, the internet was in and out. So what I tried to do tonight is to sign into two devices, and I'm only seeing where I am in just once. So maybe, oh Lord. Anyhow, let's see what will happen. I was signed into two devices, and I'm only seeing that I'm knowing once. All right.
Sorry to put you off, but so you'd prefer the Division of Labor sent to your email, or you just want us to highlight it in WhatsApp?
No. It has to be sent to me via email. No,
okay,
man.
Sir.
Right. Sorry. Yeah, man. It has to be sent to me via email. I mean, I hope you understand my position. I know the WhatsApp was used to generate the information, because the last class I believe I had with you, I asked you guys to use the last 15 minutes thereabout of the class to get your ideas together, seeing that you were there. And I've been watching the group, and I've been seeing things going, and I've not seen to say, okay, this is the final stuff. So I'm saying, once it is that you have all agree that this is the final stuff, somebody send it off to me. When you have a group, there is a leader or somebody who is going to, you know, stay up front. I need to get it as a soft copy. I'm not going to be using anything from WhatsApp. I've seen it. Yes, I will tell you that I've seen it. But I need to get something. When I get an email to say that this is it, I know that this is the final stuff. I will comment on it and I will let you know. All right. I was doing so well today. And now that I'm here talking, I feel, well, not only feel, but I hear where the voice is going again. I was ordered to just rest it and not have class, but I really can't do that. I mean, I cannot do that to you. I have to get this out of the way. It's best for me to come, give you something and leave early than just not to show up at all. I really can't do that. So forgive me for, what am I looking for? Forgive me for the sound for the longest while. I've never had this so long before, but anyhow. So as I said before, I have two topics left to complete in addition to what it is that you're doing for your project. Those two topics, I should begin one on Wednesday. And I'm seeing by next week I should be finished. By next week I should be finished. So that you will have that almost 1 week break. Based on the timetable I sent off to you today, I'm seeing where the exam is on which day again?
The 6th in the morning.
Right, that's the Tuesday, the 6th of September. So it will give you about a week. So the exam will be in the second week of your exam period. So by next week, I'll be finished off with those, with the things that I need to finish off with you. And you will have, I know you have other courses doing and we'll maybe have exams on that, at that time, but yeah. And the other two pieces that I have for you are two 10% pieces. So they're not as heavy as what it is that I would have given you as a group presentation. And I may just consider sharing it with you tonight, one of the two pieces or both pieces, so you can have an idea what it is, because as I said before, I have it already. But tonight though, what I'll do is, seeing that I've started off with somebody but talking and I'm hearing my voice going in and out, I will just go to a video, rest it off about a half an hour, and then I'll come in with some explanation as to what is going to be required of you for the other two pieces. As I said, there are two small pieces, and I'm just being very generous so that people can maximize on their scores to be able to pull through with the course, right? The individual piece is for me to get a glimpse of your knowledge, separate and apart from what it is that you're researching. Research is very important as a geologist, as an environmentalist. So the first component that I gave you is to enhance your research skills. There's another piece that I'm going to be giving you, which is going to be something on your creative aspect. And then another piece would be to get a glimpse of how you write and how you put forth an argument and to lay your points in a sequential manner. So I think I'll explain those as we go along. All right, what I did is to put something in the group just now. It's a video of what I want to look at tonight. It's about 30 minutes long. So I'm going to ask somebody who has very stable internet access, if they could just play it for me, share the screen, and go ahead and play it. Asia, is your internet up? I noticed from the other day you've been in and out. Is your internet all right now?
No, sir, it's in and out.
Yeah, Is there anybody who believes that they have
stable? I can share it.
Thank you, Ms. D. Thank you. All right, I'm going to ask that we give our undivided attention. We make notes and we can have a conversation following the video. It's in a WhatsApp group, and you can just click on the link in the WhatsApp group.
Sir, I don't have WhatsApp. I thought they were going to send it in the chat.
Oh, you don't have WhatsApp? You're not on WhatsApp?
No, sir, not
anymore. Oh, you came out of the WhatsApp group?
No, sir, I don't use WhatsApp.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear that. What was that?
I don't have WhatsApp.
Oh, so how have you been getting the information? I mean, I've been sending quite a bit of
it.
Okay. So make your answer me so strong. All right, can somebody send it to her
I'm going to try and hear.
Okay, thank you, please.
Volcanisti. Quite an interesting topic in geography. And today's topic.
Are you hearing?
Yes, dear.
Yeah. It is volcanisti, as we can see. We want to understand what volcanisti is. So let's just dive into it. What is volcanisti? We are saying this refers to all the various ways by which molten rocks and gases are forced into the earth's crust and onto its surface. That too, into the crust, and that is what we call the intrusive, and then onto the surface, and that's what we call the extrusive. So we are saying high temperatures and the great pressure exerted on the mantle by the crust keeps the rocks in semi-solid state. Such rocks are called magma. So we are saying volcanism, therefore, includes volcanic eruptions, the formation of volcanoes and lava plains, plateaus, geyser, hot springs, mentioned, and the formation of volcanic features such as batholith seals and dikes, which are within the crust. So we are saying rocks below the crust have a very high temperature, but the great pressure exerted on them by the crust keeps the rocks in semi-solid state. So we are saying the friction along rock surface at the boundaries of tectonic plates raises the temperature, and this plus a reduction in pressure caused by faulting and folding associated with movement of tectonic plates causes the rocks to become molten and semi-fluid. Such rocks are called magma. So we need to understand, how does magma come about? So the high temperature and the great pressure exerted onto the mantle. So we are saying, as the magma rises, it forces its way onto the cracks of the crust, which are caused by folding. Remember, and folding. The magma may stay in the crust, where it forms the batholiths, the seals, the dikes, the laccoliths. And these are the intrusive. It solidifies within. It may reach the surface either quietly or with great violence, as we shall see. If the magma contains a lot of gases, especially steam, then as the magma approaches the surface, the pressure on the gas is reduced. This causes the gases to expand rapidly, which gives rise to violent eruption. So we are saying we have violent and then non-violent. We are going to see that very soon in our lesson. So we are saying it is either outside the crust or inside the crust. So we're saying the pressure that is exerted on this causes the violent eruption. So when magma reaches the surface, it loses its gases and it is called lava. So what we see on the surface forming these igneous rocks now is called lava, not magma. So we move on. Hope we have understood how the molten rocks are formed and why, when it comes to the surface, it's called lava. We continue. It is onto the earth's surface. It forms extrusive features when magma slowly cools down. Within the crust, it forms intrusive volcanic features. Point to note here, that when the molten rocks are still underneath, it is called magma. But on reaching the surface, it's called lava. We have seen this earlier on. So we are saying, note this very well. So we are saying, there are two types of lava, i.e. the basque and acidic lava. Acidic lava is highly sticky and flows for a short distance before solidifying, whereas basque lava is less sticky and flows for a long distance before solidifying. So we're saying below here, we can just use this illustration to help us understand that what we see there in that photo is what we have just described as violent eruption, where now magma has been able to be ejected onto the earth surface. That's the crust, the surface of the crust. And we are saying when this reaches or the surface of the crust, we call it lava. So we're saying, when it is ejected violently, it will have to flow. So this flowing that we see here, this one here. So when it flows for a long, long distance, that is called basking lava. But when it flows for a short distance from where it has been ejected and finally solidifies, it's called acidic lava. So below here, I want us to go into this video of volcanic eruption to help us understand what we've just talked about. And before we move on into the details of volcanicity as a topic, enjoy the video.
It takes place in this video today. Oh my goodness, look at that. My goodness, that is smoke, fire, and ash that comes out fast. That is fire. My goodness. Wow, look at the intense pressure that happens. So it's due to the pressure that pushes the magma out onto the earth crust, which then turns into lava. My goodness, look at that. Wow. So the top of the mountain has been blown off. And this is what we call the violent eruption. My goodness. Look at the eruption in the side vent. Have you seen that? That's what we talk about in geography. This is so amazing. So volcanic eruption is quite interesting. At the same time, can be quite disastrous, as we can see. So it is throwing its magma fragments for quite a distance. Hope you've seen that. My goodness. So this happens because of the pressure beneath, and we talked earlier, we say that the heat due to the plates that sit onto the crust forces the rocks into the mantle to be molten rocks, which are called magma. And the red stuff that we see here, the fire kind of stuff that we see here, is actually the molten rocks. That's the magma we are talking about. But as you see, the white is disappearing, the gas going out. And then when it settles on the ground, it turns into lava. My goodness, look at that. That is fire. So when we say that igneous rocks are formed by fire, this is what we mean. My goodness, God is great. Look at that. Just look at that. It's a boiling pot. So what we see down here is the flow. We talked about being disastrous. You can see the houses burning. My goodness. Look at the lava flow. For quite distances, it can be disastrous, thus destroying vegetation, animals, and actually settlement. My goodness. What you see right now is the lava flow. Actually, it has solidified now. It has blocked even the rod. My goodness. So we're saying, basic lava is the one that flows for quite a long distance, then acidic for a short distance. So what you've just seen here that has flown for quite a long distance, that must have been basic lava. The one that you see right now in the video is basic, that is flowing for quite a long distance. My goodness, that's fire flowing. And that's the lava that we're talking about. So it will finally solidify and form the extrusive features that we talked about. My goodness. Hope this video has helped you to understand what happened during volcanic eruption. Thank you.
For just $67, you can make as many videos as you want, and you never need to pick up a camera or use
I guess it was that lovely. So we want to look at the classification of volcanoes. What we have just seen there is the active ones,
the erupting, and you've been able to see how the violent eruption happens, how the lava flows, and how it finally solidifies. So I guess that video was just quite enough for us to understand what we are talking about and why we call volcanicity as one of the interesting topics in geography. So we move on. Classification of volcanoes. So we're saying volcanoes are these features formed by the process known as volcanicity. So we're saying, number one, we have what we call active volcanoes. These are the volcanoes that are said to have erupted in the recent past. For example, in East Africa, we have the Nyamlangira. At the Congo, you get a Benson. And then we also have what we call the extinct volcanoes. These are volcanoes that have not shown any sign of activity in the historic times. For example, Mount Kenya, Erigon, and Moroto. They did erupt some time back. But in a few years past, we have not seen any sign that shows that they're about to. We continue. Then we have last classification known as dormant volcanoes. These are volcanoes which are not active, but showing signs of activity. They're expected to erupt anytime. You better be careful about it. For example, we have Kilimanjaro, Mufumbiro, Longonot, and Menengai, that is in East Africa. Across the world, there are quite a number. But we're looking at the examples in East Africa. So we're saying these ones are showing some signs of activity. They're expected to erupt anytime. So we think they've been dormant for some time. And these signs, for example, we can see the smoke. We can feel the temperature increasing. The animals leaving the steep areas of these islands. There are many, quite a number of signs that show it's about. So we're saying the dormant volcanoes are showing signs. And they've been so dormant for some time. So the classification that we have here are three: active volcanoes, extinct volcanoes, and lastly, dormant volcanoes. So we are saying active, these are volcanoes that are said to have erupted in the recent past. Sometime back, they did erupt. Then extinct volcanoes, these are volcanoes that have not shown any sign of activity in the historic times. So they've been there, but they've not shown us any sign. Then the dormant, they're saying these are volcanoes which are not active, but show signs of activity. We move on. So in this illustration, we are trying to bring out what we have just seen in the video previously. So what we see here is the process of eruption, magma coming out of the earth crust onto the surface. So we think extrusively is when it comes onto the surface of the earth. So what we see, that lava sloping down, that red color there, is what now we call the lava flow, which is flowing. We understood that we have the basic and acidic. One is sticky, the other is less sticky. So we're saying we can also have what we call intrusive, where the magma has failed to reach the earth surface. And it forms features like the sea, the dikes, the batholith, the laccolith, and many others, as we shall see. So these are formed within the earth crust. But the other features, as we shall see, the dune, the composite cone, the crater, and others are formed outside the earth crust. And those are known as extrusive. So below here is what we call the magma. And then it is moving through the lines of weakness, which are caused by either faulting or folding onto the earth surface. And then we are saying what we see here is the eruption cloud. We say it starts with the dust and the gases, then the ash, before the magma comes. So this is the ash flow that we see this other side and this other side. Ash first, then the muddy flow that was once in that area. So due to eruption, it is poof. Hope we are getting this. We move on. So we are saying, we want to start with what they call extrusive volcano features. These which are formed outside the earth crust. We're saying number one, we have the composite cone. It is made up of alternate successive layers of lava and ash. It is formed through successive eruption and ash forming through the central vent. So when eruption takes place quite some time successively, the layers of magma coming onto each other are the ones that will form the composite core. And examples of composite core in South Africa, we have the Mount Muhabara, Mount Kilimanjaro, and Mount Meru, and then Mount Elgon. We move on. Craters. It's also an example of extrusive volcano features, craters. It is a small flat flow depression or cavity on top of a volcano. It is formed when the top of a volcano is blown off through a violent eruption. And when it is filled with water, it forms crater lakes. Quite a number in East Africa. We have quite a number. For example, the Queen Elizabeth kind of Gempa. Quite a number. And the examples are given below here. We move on. So we are saying, this is a diagram, a photo to show us how a composite cone looks like. We are saying it is made up of alternate stroke, successive layers of lava. Lava. Remember we said lava is the one that comes on the earth surface when the gases disappear. It's not magma now, it's lava. So successive layers, as we can see on this one here, the layers of lava flowing due to continuous kind of eruption, it forms a composite cone. But we move on. This other side, we are seeing what we call a crater. And we're saying it is a small flat flowed depression or cavity on top of a volcano. It is formed when the top of a volcano is blown off through violent eruption. So that's what we're seeing down here. That what you see here is a small, not actually small, it's big, but a sharp kind of depression, cavity on top of this volcano. It's blown off when violent eruption happens. So this can help us understand what we always look at theoretically. Now practically we can see this in photos and understand them better. We move on. Other features of extrusive volcanic features. We move on. We have the caldera. It is an enlarged crater. Remember we have seen the crater initially, but now this is a caldera. It is an enlarged crater. I can take you back to a crater. This is the crater we're talking about. But now when it is enlarged due to the erosion process, it's going to be called
the crazy loophole, where you just do 4 hours of work and it generates a new income stream that keeps.
a caldera. So it's an analyzed crater. It is formed due to violent eruption. Examples in East Africa have been a park, Ngorongoro in northern Tanzania, Bangai, Menangai, Longnot Mission. These are examples in East Africa, across the world. There are quite a number, many. Next is lava plains. This is an upland with a flat, stroke gentle sloping surface, made of several layers of lava, 1,000 meters thick. So we say it is formed when basic lava, which is not viscous or viscous, which flows or not sticky, which flows for a long time before solidifying. So this lava is able to flow quite kilometers, quite meters without solidifying. So when it flows for quite a long distance, it forms what we call the lava plain. The lava plain. Hope we're together. We move on. Next, we have volcanic plug. This is formed when molten lava solidifies in a vent and later exposed on the earth's surface by processes of erosion. Denudation kind of processes. So it is within, but later exposed. Then ash and cedar cone. These are small symmetrical cones of pyroclast, less than 150 meters with fairly steep sides between. So we're saying ash and cedar cones. They're small symmetrical cones on top of these volcanoes, where the vents, where the outlets of the volcanoes were. So they form as due to the successive kind of eruption, when it finally stops, the lava that solidifies around that area forms a cone. So in this, below here, we are saying this is a caldera. Why? So we are saying it is enlarged kind of crater due to erosion. So it is wide. So this is what we call, what we refer to as a caldera. There are quite a number also in areas of Potro. Then next is the lava plain. This is lava which has been flowing quite for a long distance. And we're saying this type of lava is known as basquiat lava. So here, what we see here, this one is not yet even, has not yet even cooled down. You can see it is still red. This other black one has already cooled down. So this expanse kind of, extensive kind of area of lava is what we call the lava plain. On the other side is what we see. What we see there is the volcanic plug. Examples of this in Uganda, we have the Toro Rock. So it comes out of the ground. This was lava trying to come onto the earth surface, but solidified within the vent. And that's what led to the formation of a volcanic plug. Now we have others, the hot spring. This is a feature that's produced when heated water in the volcanic area flows out in form of hot spring. Then the geysers is also a hot spring that erupts periodically, shooting out of water and steam in the area. For example, hot springs near Mtanda, Western Uganda, Chitagata in Rushenyi, Sempaya in Bundibujo, Majimoto in Tanzania, quite a number, and these are found in the volcanic kind of areas. We shall understand the geography of the water spring, but now we are looking at futures form, which is extrusive kind of volcanic. So these are examples of pictures trying to show us the water springs. Later in this lesson, we shall have a video about them. So you can see this is water, hot, really hot water. You can see even the steam here. And it's due to the hot temperatures within the earth crust. As we said last time, when you looked at the lava or the magma, is hot. So the temperatures caused by these different layers exerted onto the crust, they increase the temperatures, which temperatures actually boil this water as it comes onto the surface, forming the hot spring.
We're a community of over 19,000 doctors. We have practiced at all
We move on to the intrusive volcanic features. We've been looking at extrusive things outside. Now I want to look at things inside, intrusive volcanic features. And this will conclude our lesson today. These are formed when magma does not reach the earth's surface, but simply solidifies within the earth crust. In some cases, such features have been exposed to the surface by denudation. For example, we have quite a number in Muvende, Nakasongo, South, and these are examples within East Africa. Across the world, are quite a number. So these include the lapolith, the lacolith, the batholith, the dike, and the seal. So these are intrusive volcanic features which are formed within the earth crust. Lava does not go out or outside the crust. It just solidifies, slowly solidifies within the earth crust, forming such features. So below here is the photo to just briefly show us. So this is outside. We talked about the ash cone, remember, in extrusive. But now we are interested in those ones that are formed within the earth crust, not outside the earth crust. So we have the dike, we have the batholith, we have the seal, and then we have the lacolith. So these are features formed within the earth crust. Magma solidifies within, does not reach the earth surface. So with this, we'll have to end today's lesson, and I'll leave you with a video of the hot springs that'll help you to understand what you've just been looking at. Thank you very much. See you next time.
Thank you, Michael. All right, now, first things first. I don't want any one of them to laugh after the man's accent. You hear me? Because some of the words him call, I don't know. Anybody know what him call magma? What is it from magma? Anyone hearing?
I think it was magma, but I know I can't. So I heard him, but I realized that he was trying to say magma.
Right. Please don't laugh at him. Don't be like your teacher here. persons who we had teaching us at Mono were, hold on, I had just a few Jamaicans that taught us. And if I can recall, I know a Jamaican taught me hydrogeology, and a Jamaican taught me economic geology. I'll have to sit back and think about it, but everybody else that taught me were non-Jamaicans. One or two Indians, and we go to class, and trust me, I don't think, like the first class we went to, we learn a thing, because all we do is just laughing after the person. We don't learn a thing until we understood the person's accent. Very knowledgeable on what it is. I don't know if anybody heard a passion that he used to present, what it is that he was presenting. I mean, I felt the passion. Anybody felt the passion?
Somewhat,
sir. Say it again, Dodie.
I was saying somewhat.
Yeah, man, he was very passionate about what it is that he has, but in what it is that he presented. So quite a bit of things he did. And yeah. Very, very, very. Some of the things though that the references, I wouldn't, it sometimes is very difficult for me to find, you know, to find those examples within our region. You know, most of the examples he gave was in Africa, West Africa in particular. Nonetheless, what I like is that he was able to use pictures to explain. All right. So one or two things. What's the difference between lava and magma again?
The location. Magma is inside, and lava is the flow is external.
Okay. So give me another word for external again.
Extrusive.
Right, another one, internal is?
Intrusive.
All right, very good. So hold on to that, because we're going to go somewhere with it. And I mean, you have this video that you can go and rewatch, and you can find other videos too that can help you to do this stuff. And let me just put something out there to you. You see, when we were studying, we never have them videos here. So all we had to do is to look into a book and look at black and white photos. You see all those volcanoes that come with a pyroclastic flow. The pyroclastic flow volcano is the one that leaves an umbrella of, you know, like when you talk about a plume of smoke, the pyroclastic flow leaves that umbrella word of ash in the atmosphere. No plane can fly if you have like a pyroclastic flow unbeknownst to a pilot, and he flies through that region. Best believe the plane going to go down. Best believe the plane is going to go down. Because when all that ash and silt and dust gets into the engine, it is going to clog. And I guarantee you, that one of the engines going to go first, if not both engines going at the same time. It's very important. So if, for argument's sake, Bossman a fly over a mountainous area that is very active and he doesn't know, you understand the importance now of air traffic controllers, because they are monitoring all of these activities now. Seismologists are communicating to them to say, guess what, we're getting some strange readings, vibrations that are coming up, because when this magma starts to get very volatile, you will feel the vibration within on the surface of the Earth's crust. The vibration taking place within, you will feel the vibration there. So seismologists will be able to say, ha 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 ha, hold on. There is an anomaly that is taking place right here. And they will know the active or the dormant volcanoes within the areas. Trust me, when you look at a volcanic map, they plot all these volcanoes around. So when they are looking, and trust me, a volcanologist, a seismologist, they find a storm chaser, they find so much fun. Just imagine your teacher here are going to run down a tornado because me want to get data, me want to get information about it. What a life. I'd rather sell star and gleaner. So I'm running in the direction, and everybody's running away from it. You know, I'm running in the direction because I want to record wind speed. I want to see firsthand the damage. But guess what? They're doing all of that so that you and I can have information, video clippings and everything of the tornadoes that take place. They live for this. Volcanologists, they live for this. They have them plane ticket put on. So if them in the United States and here, say in Timbuktu, a volcano erupt, trust me, vaccine or no vaccine, the man them a jump on one plane and them a suit up, because what? They now need to go on and do the mineralogy, which is our next topic that we're going to be moving into. They need to do the mineralogy now of the intrusive rocks within the Earth's crust that will come out, so they can check to see what is happening. They're actually taking the temperature of what is happening. So this is how they get, this is how it gives an idea of the temperature within the Earth's crust. So when this magma comes to the floor to form lava, they are taking the temperature. Kan is a normal thermometer, you know. They're using your own device to take the temperature. And when the temperature is taken, they will say, ha-ha, this temperature is greater than the last volcano that erupted a couple of meters from here. So it means that the temperature here is higher. The pressure that is being generated or exerted on the Earth's crust is greater. So these volcanologists now are doing a lot of geological calculations to find out what is really happening. They are so interested to know what is happening within the Earth's crust. All right. So this magma, it stayed there and it boil up, and it gets very hot, and a lot of gases are being produced. When these gases are produced, it looks for imperfections within the structure of the Earth. What are these imperfections called?
Fissures.
Fissures,
vents.
Very good. Faults and folds and them something you don't.
Yes, sir.
Yes, ma'am. You must talk to me, man, because this is very exciting stuff, you know. So when all of these imperfections now cause, it's just like, and one of the things that put me to it, you know, he was so excited and said, oh, God is good. So the man connected to me right there, saying, because the man sound like him a Christian, right? So right there, then me feel connected with the man, you know, because it's just like the devil. The devil knows where me vulnerable. So if he knows, say, chocolate is what we're not supposed to eat, he might go send me everywhere where them sell chocolate. White chocolate, black chocolate, this a chocolate with drunk butter in it, but me can't eat. And incidentally, drunk butter is white rum. And the likes, and I'm going to say, oh, let me just have a little piece of it. And this is what the devil does. He knows where we are vulnerable, and he uses our vulnerability to cause us to sin. By extension, that's exactly what the magma does. It looks for the imperfections within the structure of the earth to say, here's the plan. You see that little fracture here? You see that fault here, so? So we're going to open up. This is what is going to come out. Because we are gonna do it. Bam! We have a volcanic eruption. And this volcanic eruption now you have many different types of volcanic eruption. Plinian type, the pyroclastic flow type. This course is really not to look at the different types of volcanoes. I mean, when you get into other stuff, you'll see the different types. So you have some volcanoes that shoot up right up into the air. You have some of them that shoot up and forms a blanket. That is the one that forms the pyroclastic flow. All right? Now, it comes out, and then you even have those that are acidic and those that are basic. The ones that are acidic, how do we differentiate between the acidic ones and the basic ones? The acidic flow versus the basic flow.
One of them is sticky and mm-hmm. moves slowly.
Mm-hmm. Which is the?
That's the basic.
Mm-hmm. Say it again.
The acidic one is the one that moves slow and is sticky.
Okay. And what about the basic?
That one moves more freely.
Okay. Are you sure about that?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So why are you so unsure?
Yes, sir. The basic is viscous.
Extremely viscous. Extremely viscous. It moves at snail pace. Snail pace. And it's a basic flow. Snail pace. That the one there. By the way, which of them you think is more dangerous? The one that moves very quickly or the one that moves slowly?
The one that moves quicker.
Why?
Because persons, for instance, in the vicinity, they might not get any chance to react as quickly.
Mm-hmm. The rest of you agree with him?
So the one was slow.
Why?
The one that's slower can tend to cool quicker.
Excuse you? The one that what? Moves slower tends to cool quicker?
Yeah.
No, sir. I disagree with you right there. The one that moves slow. Okay. You're saying to me then that the one that moves slower cools quicker?
Yes, sir. That's what I was saying.
All right. I want you to think about it. The rest of you, think about it. Let us analyze that to see if the one that moves faster, if you think that one cools quicker than the one that moves slower. Which one do you think cools quicker?
Sir, I would say the basic, because it moves faster and cover a larger surface area.
Hold on. The basic moves faster or slower? Don't get it mixed up, you know.
Hold on.
Sir, I would say that acidic runs slower and cools faster, and the basic runs faster and cools slower.
Tinder, who was it now? Michael, do me a favor. Can you play back the first part of the video for me, please?
Okay, sir.
Volcanistry, quite an interesting topic in geography. And today's topic is volcanistry, as we can see.
Scroll down, Mikey, to see if you can scroll to the acidic versus basic.
What is volcanistry? And why, when it comes to the surface, it's cold? Sticky
and flows for a long distance.
Pause it right there. Pause it right there.
So we're saying.
All right. So it says that there are two types, the basic and the acidic. The acidic is highly sticky and it flows for a short distance before solidifying. The basic lava is less sticky and flows for a long distance solidifying. So which is which? The acidic one is highly sticky and it flows for a short distance. The basic lava is less sticky and it flows for a long distance. So which of the two is more viscous?
So the basic.
The acidic, yes, yeah.
It would be the acidic.
The acidic. Yeah, it's more viscous.
It acidic would be more viscous than the basic. The basic will have less viscosity. So the basic lava is less sticky and it flows for a long distance. All right? So let me ask a question. So keep it right here for me, please. So let me ask a question. Let me ask a question. Oh, goodness. Where was the question? What did I ask again? Okay. So my question to you is which would you prefer if you had a choice? Which would you prefer? If you ask me, you know, I don't want none of them. But say you don't have a choice. Would it be the acidic one or the basic one?
Sir, personally, sir, mm-hmm. You have to look at which lava is associated with which type of volcano and explosion.
So, yeah, man, we know that. But I'm talking about the flow, you know. I'm talking about the lava now, you know. It's lava I'm talking about, you know. So I'm talking
about the basic.
So I'm saying to you, would you prefer something that is more viscous or less viscous?
More viscous.
And Paz, you said more viscous because you're saying that it gives you more time to invade the area.
Flow.
Right.
Yeah, oh, and that's what I'm thinking about.
Right. And then now somebody was saying, go ahead.
I would say less viscous. For some reason, I'm leaning towards that one.
Okay, let me.
The less viscous is the basic one.
The less viscous is the basic one, yeah. So it's not a right or wrong answer. I'm just asking because I want to hear what it is that you're. What I'm trying to do with you guys, let me just tell you. What I'm trying to do with you guys is to help to sharpen your thinking skill. I want to ask you questions outside of the box because this is what is going to be required of you to do your exams, to do your assignments. I want you not only to stick to something slavishly. To say this is this, I want you to be able to think about it and speak of it, on it. Now, Saint Vincent, the last erupted volcano within the Caribbean. How would you call that the lava flow? Would you say that it was viscous or high viscosity or low viscosity?
High viscosity.
You say that it was high viscosity, okay. Anybody else?
I would have said high viscosity as well.
So you thought that, so what you're saying to me that you thought that the lava flowed very quickly?
No, sir.
So that you get it mixed up then. Because if it is very viscous, it means that it moves very slow. And yes, if it is
so wouldn't it be high viscous? Would be moving slow?
Yeah, so what I'm saying to you, is it more viscous or is it less viscous?
Yeah.
Which one you think it is? You're saying that it's the one that was with more viscous. Okay, so you're saying that was the case. Okay, and because the people are able to escape, that's what you're saying, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Not only because of they're being able to escape, but because mm-hmm. of the type of explosion that was associated with
the eruption. Yeah. Agreed. Totally agreed. All right. Which one is it caused? Yeah. I mean, I remember in the 90s when the volcano in Montserrat was dormant.
1997.
Yeah?
1997.
Talk truth. I was studying at that time, and I had a friend who left for Montserrat in 1990, she stayed in Montserrat 1996, 1997, and we had evidence of it being dormant. But remember, when it's dormant, you know, you still can know the activity is going on, but it's just not come up, but you can hear the rumbling of the volcano within the magma within. You can hear things happening inside. Seismologists were able to speak of different sensors that are coming off, and I'm saying, are you sure you want to do this? This was my primary school mate. I said, you sure you want to do that? Yes, because I'm going on an exchange French program and I want to improve on my French and so forth and so on. I said, okay, fine. And in my mind, I say, me got to go my black suit because me not think I could come back. Long and short, came back, turned lawyer and big practicing lawyer. Right? No. But for me, if you hear my view, when the lava flow has high viscosity, meaning that it is moving very slow, I agree with Paz, it causes residents to be able to get out almost unharmed, as opposed to the one with less viscosity that moves very quickly. You have to run, take up your foot and literally run. Now, what are some of the implications of a volcanic eruption to a country? Were you hearing me?
Yes,
what are some of the what, sir?
What are some of the implications? What are some of the things that you know, even the one that happened recently within the Caribbean? What are some of the things that you that could be as a result of a volcanic activity?
Reduction in the visibility. You can have respiratory problems, especially for babies.
Water contamination.
Yeah.
Not just respiratory problems, especially for babies, because you have some adults too that have serious respiratory problems. Yeah, so respiratory problems on a whole. What about pollution?
Water pollution, air pollution. Especially for the neighboring countries.
Yeah, but what other pollution can you talk about? Water pollution, air pollution, what other pollution? What about noise pollution?
Yeah.
You don't know that is pollution.
That man, sir. I'm not concerned with that man.
I'll let you tell.
You're talking about when the volcano erupts?
Yes, sir. Yes, miss. I know what you're is that.
Oh, yes, sir.
Of course. When you hear the rumbling of one, and you can't sleep. No, just imagine you live close to this area and you lay down for close your eye. Matter of fact, me not lay down there, so I think we can imagine it. Because the moment me know, say, this volcano start to talk, me is leaving. One of the things that pained my heart was to look at the loss of cattle, agricultural loss, farming loss. People, we don't know how Mike would manage. People didn't have time enough to let loose their cows and their goats and their chickens and their pigs, and they just had to leave them. Where will hear them go? You don't have time enough to slaughter them. What are you going to be doing? Dogs, cats. I remember seeing where one picture, well, a video actually, of the lava flowing and catch a light post and it start burn the light post. Right? So these are some of the things that will happen. So it burns the light post then drops on the house. The light wires gets on the roof and gets tangled into all that is happening and cause additional fire. The cars couldn't move because, the cars start burn up. It touches the gas tank. What do you expect to happen?
Explosion.
Yes, man. Imagine those people who have them 100-pound cylinder out a door. It thinks them good things, say, oh, let us remove the cylinder. When trouble take you, you start run up and down. So you just buy your own, you just fill your 100-pound cylinder and the flow in your backyard and it touch this, it touch your 100-pound cylinder. What do you expect to happen? Hello, somebody?
Explosion.
A serious explosion right there, sir. And remember, one is going to be more dangerous than the other because the oil in your car is really not under pressure, but the oil in the cylinder is under pressure. True or false?
True.
Yeah. So which one do you think will create a bigger explosion?
The one that's under more pressure.
The one that is under more pressure, which is a cylinder, which is exactly what is happening to the raucous behavior of these volcanoes. Because the gases are under so much pressure. When they get to the surface, them just blow out. You know, like when you lock up in a COVID. And when COVID, and when we hear the thing, them just get loose, and we just start going over the place, and then after that, because we go to the place, and we start go a party, and we start go, well, not we. They started going to the party, and so forth, and so on. The cases went up, and the man have locked me back down. Right? Because we are locked up, we're under pressure. So when we get the opportunity now to break loose, and we break loose, we just explode. It's a big explosion, right? Because these gases now need oxygen that, you know, it really need now, and it does big thing, big something. All right. So it has a multifaceted effect. The water resources people, they must get involved. The rescue people, they have to get involved. The light and power people have to get involved. The housing people have to get involved. You talk about agricultural people have to get involved. All manner of crops are going to go bad. In neighboring countries, in Barbados, they were experiencing results of cash. Yes, ma'am. People can't wash them clothes. People have to lock up in their house. And with paper and them curtains, so that if any ash come on the damp curtain, at least it don't get into the house. It stays there on the curtain and just be damped. People had to be sealing their doors. People had to be wearing masks before COVID. I wonder if that caused COVID anyhow. All right.
Remember the volcanic eruption in Montserrat in 1997, we experienced
absolutely ash, absolutely we did because I don't know if you can find, go back, see if you can scroll, Mikey, to the picture, the still picture that I had with the dikes and the periclastic flow, because the direction of the wind, yeah, continue going. Well, if you look at that, well, no, continue going. There's a still picture of it showing the intrusion, the extrusion, the dike, the periclastic flow, the basalt. Well, just look at that. My God. Right there. See there. Right? So let us look at the prevailing wind to the top right-hand corner. You see where the prevailing wind is? So because of the prevailing wind, it is blowing to the left. Can you see that?
Yes, sir. Which part? The acid rain. The ash acid rain.
The ash acid rain. Yes, man. Because it is blowing. So now if the wind is coming that side, any neighboring communities or countries, I will feel it. Look at the Sahara dust. You know from, you know where that come from? It come from fur.
Okay.
Yes. And we have it in Jamaica here. We have evidence of it in Jamaica. All right? So, and because sometimes the pyroclastic flow that comes up right there is the ash, as it says, ash, is so fine. So fine. It stays in the atmosphere for quite a while. It stays there for quite a while, quite some time. And then it comes down as acid rain. It comes down as acid rain. So you have the ash flow coming there as one other pollutant now. So ash will cover up everything. The holes where you're walking, you know, it gets into your lungs. It causes blockage of your bronchioles, so you can't breathe, so you suffocate. Boom, you drop them dead. Right? So it has a lot of ripple effects, a lot of ripple effects. A volcanic eruption, right?
But it can also have positive effects as well,
such as.
So like you can use the ash for energy,
mm-hmm.
produce electricity. The ash can also be used for nutrients for the plants.
For plants, okay, yeah, and
I think there's one other one.
Okay, so let me ask you. New land formation is one too, yes, but let me ask you. In a volcanic eruption, will the positives outweigh the negatives? And one may say it depends on the type of eruption. But if you look at one that like one with the pyroclastic flow, like the one that we're looking at now, the positives may not outweigh the negatives. Because one, you're going to be thinking about the loss of lives, the loss of agricultural crops, the loss of, housing and businesses and, you know, for people to get back to some normal way of living, it may take years in order for that to be rebuilt. So when you're talking about using it for as fertilizers, for argument's sake, what land crop are you going to fertilize when everything was damaged? That's one. New land formation, yeah, but it's going to cost so much more for you to rebuild. If the new land formation you're talking about now is, if you have, for argument's sake, and I think maybe this is where you're going, Michael, if you have a volcanic eruption that takes place in the oceanic crust, and you have an island now being formed within the ocean, that is different. That is different. Huh?
Just like the small island that is formed next door to Montserrat.
Absolutely. But guess what? Guess what? my ear's popping. But guess what? The damage in itself is, we may not see it because it is taking place within the oceanic crust, but you can have a volcanic eruption within the oceanic crust in the sea, and it is literally wiping out aquatic life forms. So the livelihood, go ahead.
Remember that in these instances where you would have underwater volcanoes, the life form that would be there would have already adapted.
Yes, and some of them would already migrate.
Exactly. Right,
to other parts. But what I'm saying to you, put it this way. If you live in an area where you feel safe, but that safe zone is now under attack, and you have to go to a zone where you have to walk and hold your pocket, how safe would you feel in that area? I guess one would say not very safe. So I'm talking about different life forms now. Different types of fish may be at risk because they are now out of their quote-unquote neck of the woods. They're going into a danger zone. Because life form in the ocean is similar to life form in Jamaica now. Because I'm sure, Mackie, you wouldn't want to go into one of those depressing communities to live in. Because the moment they see you in a depressing community, they're going to say, where did they come from? I'm a move, so. Right? Which is the point I'm making. Because they're going to see you want to go into your car. They're going to see you want to come out in your nice clothes. And they're going to say, no, man, you don't look like you want to come show you up. All right, you're the problem. I'm going to hold him up and go rob him. And when God forbid them robbing on them, see what you look like. They're going to say, no, man, we're going to take him out. Right? So when you migrate in the ocean also, there are different parts of the ocean that becomes a little saltier than other parts because of the chemical reaction. And when you move to the upper level, you'll hear more about that, the chemical reactions taking place within the oceanic crust. All right? So you can have a reduced amount of oxygen there. It means that the fish will not be able to survive for too long. All right? So you're pretty much going to be wiping out life form. The temperature of the water is going to increase. And the temperature of the water increases, it is also going to cause you life form to also go away. All right? So it has, yes, you may have positives, but with the positives, you're going to have disruption in what it is that we are doing, right? But just to bring across a point, we have previously looked at the temperature within the crust of the earth. When we look at the structure of the earth, and we recognize that it moved from about 4,400 to 6,700 degrees Celsius, which is very high, right? Now this magma being heated up is looking for this, for areas of imperfection, so it is that it can come up. And when it finds that area of imperfection, with the gases there under pressure, the moment the gases be able to get to the surface, this is how craters are being formed, because you may have an explosion when it reaches the surface. And this is how you have your craters being produced. All right? So it is...
Sir, and I didn't remember, I just remember now, what about mineral formation as well?
Yes, that too, because you'll have new formation because of the making and the breaking of these bonds and the temperatures at which these things are occurring. You're going to have the formation of new minerals, right? But the question is, will these minerals be in a mineable portion? As I would have said to you, I saw an intrusion evidence of a volcanic eruption. Remember, we talk about denudation. So you have a volcanic eruption that is taking it, but it just did not. You have the magma heating up, but it just didn't break the surface of the earth. But because of some other activity, we are seeing evidence of what took place within the earth's crust years later. And we were able to see, where we define that door, Jesus? I think in Clarendon, we're able to go across and looked at what would have been,
Rio Mio.
The Rio Mino?
Yeah.
Right, across from over there. I think it was like the Ballas River, which is the same Rio Mino there. We looked across and we saw some intrusion. So listen to me. When you have a lecturer like mine, fearless, this white man, fearless, he's saying, come with me. And I said, come where? This is water. And he said, okay, fine. Mark you, we eventually went. And we had to wade across the water. And we went and we looked and we were able to see, you know, we used a magnifying glass, we were able to find what they call pyrite, which is fool's gold. But they're saying that if they were to mine it, it will not be in, because it was, because of the impurities, when they will do the electrolysis, the amount of sludge that will come out in, to purify the gold, it would be an effort in futility, because it won't be in mineable portions, right? It won't be in mineable portions. But we have evidence of it here in Jamaica. We have evidence of it here in Jamaica, right? So yes, there are some positives. Island formation is one biggie to it, to the point where some people may say, here the plan, I want to purchase this island. And the man may have a little money, you know, maybe the person who owns Windalco. Anyhow, just saying, may have a little money and go and purchase the island and may do a little something, so you have a little private island that, you know, you want to go on and have a staycation, that you go your boat it out to this nice little island that is well built, and they use solar energy, because, you know, them going have a challenge getting electricity over there. So it is really solar, and it's really you know, they don't use toilet paper, they go and they use you know, recycle their stuff and the whole works. So it happens. All right. What else? Scroll again for me, please, Mike. There's something else that I needed to talk about. There's something else. All right. Yeah, stop right there. Go back down that bit, pop up. Oh, sorry, the ad. Right. So exposit. So when you look at the lava plain. Paz, this is one of the things I wanted to say to you. When you look at the lava plain there, you're talking about lowland formation, yeah. But what is it going to take now in order for you to build in an era such as this? Talk to me about that. Are you hearing me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, man. What are your views about that mass of lava plain that you're looking at?
Lava
plane.
Yeah.
To me, it might be a bit difficult to
to do anything like this, don't.
Yeah, I don't think it would be possible.
And so this is what Mikey was saying to, you know, it depends on the volcanic eruption, right? Because it may have an eruption that don't have that mass of a lava plane. That we are seeing in this picture here. So it depends on the type of volcanic eruption that, you know, it determines the the magnitude of the damage that is done, right? We didn't talk about the gases that come off.
Sorry, you know, I would have done that lava plane. I grind up that and sell it as building material.
Aggregates,
yeah.
And they do this because, I mean, in order for them to reconstruct roads, that's what they will do. They will bring in these machines so they can do the stuff. As I talk about that, obsidian is one of those minerals, one of those things that we look at, you know, with that sort of conchoidal fracture that is there. It's glass-like, so it depends on the pyroclastic flow. But yes, you can use it as an aggregate. As a matter of fact, what could be done is that you could even export these aggregates to neighboring countries that can be used in road construction.
Sir, obsidian, is it a quart that you can actually see through?
You can't, well, the ones that I've seen, you can't see through it, but it's black, but it's glass-like looking, with a sort of conchoidal fracture, which is like a C-shaped fracture that is very smooth, which is a volcanic rock.
So the ones that are by Hector's estate there, we can actually see through them, which quart is that?
It could be an obsidian. Depends on. I'd have to see what it looks like. I don't know what it is.
It's clear like diamond, but it's not diamond.
So that means quartz. Because some people confused quartz with diamond, right? The diamond is well, the quartz is more translucent than the obsidian. The obsidian is dark color, right? So it more sounds like quartz to me, but when you shine a light through it, it won't reflect that sort of light, and that's how you differentiate the diamond from it. So you know, when you have a diamond ring, for argument's sake, and you shine the light from it, you can see the different hues coming off, the pinks and the purples and the gray. It reflects the light, you know, like when people have their courier cabinet in the corner and then put a little spotlight on it with a little diamond inside, and you can say, wow, it glistens. Yeah, so it is reflecting light. The quartz don't reflect light that way. You get me?
Yes, sir.
Man.
Just that my dear teacher didn't take all the stone from us. I was wondering if it had value.
If the quartz has value?
Yeah.
Yes, man.
Oh, it is actually a value.
Yes, man. It is not as valuable as a diamond. Yeah, man. It has value, man. You see, the minerals of the earth, you know, they all have values. You know, one of the things that If I can remember it now, when you're looking at the harness, Trinidadian girls can flirt and other queer things can do. So Trinidadian girls can flirt and other queer things can do. Good. You see that Trini, that T in the scale is for talc, which is one of those minerals. Then other queer is would be for quartz. Things can do. You see that D, which will be the tenth one. We're talking about a hardness. It's going to be diamond. So diamond is more. It's harder. It takes more to crush diamond than it is for quartz. So when you look at the hardness of these minerals, you recognize that diamond is much more harder in comparison to quartz. So quartz has a hardness of about 7. Diamond has a hardness of 10. All right. So there are several things that you can use to differentiate between quartz and diamond. Right. But this man, so all of these have important stuff. So you see, like talc. So when you look at the hardness scale, Trinidadian girls, Trinidadian talc girls, gypsum. Gypsum is used in the construction industry to make ceiling material, talk truth.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, man.
Right out of Rockford.
Right out of Rockford, right there, sir. As a matter of fact, the new type of roof them know where the man them are use with the Lord Jesus, the drywall. It is some of the gypsum that they use inside of the drywall, but it's just different from the other gypsum that they used to use beforehand, before time. Right? Talc is one of those things that use, matter of fact, I heard on the news the other day that Johnson and Johnson is coming out of business.
Because of the talcum powder.
Because of the talcum powder. So the talc that the Johnson & Johnson uses from the same minerals that we're talking about. Right? Because it is believed to be a carcinogen. And a lot of women are saying that they will have ovarian cancer as a result of using the talcum powder. So the amount of lawsuit that they have against them say, you're the plan, it is good enough for us to go call bankrupt and just get out of business. All right? So it does have its purpose and its use. As a matter of fact, there's another one, I can't remember it just now, that is used in the medical field. When you break a limb, they use the powder itself and mix it water in order for them to wrap
to make the cast.
Yeah, man. Yeah. We found some of that exposure in the Mavis Bank area, and we were wondering what on earth this is. And when we took it back to school, our lecturer was saying to us that, hey, this is it. I mean, I'm killed with dead, we'd have to go back and get a little something out of it for ourselves. But of course, other things took place, so we couldn't go back up there because we kind of discovered some other stuff. But yeah, so all of these things have a lot of use, within a lot of industry, medical and otherwise. Right? Yeah, man. A whole lot of use, man. So yeah, so you know, and even if you look at the caldera there, I mean, people can just use that now to hike. Because who would want to go and build on the hill right there, so? You know, some people decide that they want to live on top of a hill. I am not one of those. Because I would have to know the geological past of this thing, Bob, to know exactly what it is that I'm doing. All right? But, yeah, so in a nutshell, Rockstone. I didn't recognize the time run off so quickly. But in a nutshell, this is what it is. I'm going to ask that you just go through the video again. Look at it. I don't want you to just slavishly look at the video. I want you to be able to extrapolate the things that will come from the video. Some of the catastrophes that can happen. Not because as a geologist, you can't just look at what is happening to the earth, because remember, the earth is occupied by us humans. So if something happens to the earth, the first life form that we're talking about is us, because we have dominion over everything else on the earth. So we will be, humans will be the first life form that we need to try to preserve. And we're talking about pollution, different types of pollution, the disruption of lives, the disruption of livelihood, etc. So I want you to be able to think outside of the box. And the final thing I'll say to you is, if you, for argument's sake, were employed to an environmental agency, and say, for example, the RGR calls for an interview because another Caribbean country has a volcanic eruption, and Jamaicans don't understand what is happening, because fortunately we don't have any of those active volcanoes right now, and they want you to do some public education. What are some of the things you can speak about? So the host may say, what are some of the the effects of having a volcano. You speak about the disruption of life on the continental crust and the oceanic crust. Jesus, we call oceanic crust, we call continental crust. So right there and then you have an opportunity to talk about that. So you can talk about what happens in the sea, you talk about what happens on land, you talk about all these different things, because it's a geologic occurrence, but the geologic occurrence now has implications for life form and how it is that we live and what we can do. Mikey says, you know what we can do, sir? We can crush these lava from the lava plain when it is cooled as aggregates. Yeah, that can be done. It has been used many times over. All right. So we have to be able to not just see the event, but we can speak about things surrounding the events, the after effect of the event, so to speak. Right, and just like how we spoke about Windalco and their effluent, so one activity is emptying the effluent in the Rio Cobre, and we know what it is. It's pollution of the oceanic crust, but we cannot stop the conversation there. We have to now look at what did this river provide, and it provides this, that, so forth and so on. And we went through all of that already. So therefore, we have to find ways of mitigating the occurrence of this some other time. I was doing some research there today, and I saw where in 2021, there was another effluent discharge by Windalco in the Cobre. So it's like every year we have things like these happening. So even though it's a geological event, we now have to extrapolate the things that are happening outside of that geological event to human life forms, right? So it's an interesting read. It's an interesting discipline. I want you to be able to put on your environmental cap when it is that you're, you know, speaking about these issues. Thanks for coming out. I really hope that by Wednesday I am in a much clearer tone, so it is that we can start the second to last area. I will look at the email that was sent to me, and we'll have conversations on Wednesday as it relates to preparation for the presentation early next week. Have a good night. Thank you.
Thank you,
ma'am.